20. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three.
Now, the girl at this side, if you come out just a wee tiny bit, that's fine. And if you all look towards me here, that's looking good.
Nowadays, the only time people use a professional photographer is on their wedding day.
Here we are. Can I bring the lady forward?
Murray, Mum, get out the road.
In the Victorian era, a trip to the photographer's was a great occasion. But as photography has become simpler and less expensive, more and more people have started taking their own pictures.
Ready? Get that one again. Ready? Lovely. Now, do you have the wedding ring with you? That's good. Turn this way. I can only apologise for the background here, but I'll repeat them at the reception. That's it. And bride's dad, if you come forward. If you come right forward to here, bride's dad, and I was going to get one of you looking through the window here at your daughter, come right forward. That's the idea.
I'll be with you in just a second.
I'll tell you before I take it. Excuse me, the bride's dad...
Sophisticated cameras are used just as often by amateurs as by professionals, and the quality of many amateurs' work is as high as that of their professional counterparts.
And I've got one of bride alone here now.
And so it has been since the beginning of photography.
Okay, I won't hold you up now. I'll get the other one.
The work of the two best-known Scottish photographers, David Octavius Hill and Robert Adamson, was an early collaboration between amateur and professional. Adamson was the professional photographer with a studio at Rock House on Edinburgh's Calton Hill, while Hill was primarily a landscape painter. Their portraits of the fisher folk of Newhaven are fine examples of the way Adamson's technical skills complemented Hill's feeling for lighting and composition. Hill reputedly had great personal charm, and this is reflected in the relaxed attitude of his subjects to the camera, a remarkable achievement, considering they had to remain perfectly still during the exposure time of between 1 and 3 minutes. Robert Adamson had learnt the calotype process, the first to use a negative, in 1841 from his brother John in St Andrews. In 1843, he moved to Edinburgh to open Scotland's first calotype studio. Hill used photography like a sketchbook, many of the photographs being studies for his large canvases. A trip to Edinburgh Castle resulted in a series of group portraits of the soldiers stationed there. These were calotype studies for a large oil painting by Hill, admired at the time for its accuracy of detail. The partnership ended with Adamson's death in 1848 at the age of 27. In 5 years, they had amassed in the region of 2,500 calotype studies, now considered classics of photography. At about the same time, members of the Edinburgh Calotype Club were beginning to take their cameras outside Scotland. These views of Rome, small salt prints from calotype negatives, are by Robert McPherson, a surgeon, and Sir James Francis Dunlop. McPherson was later to settle in Rome and became one of the city's finest architectural photographers. He and Dunlop appear to have worked together, as is evident by the close similarities between these pictures from one of the club's albums. This early panoramic view was achieved by joining together three separate photographs. It is only natural that it would be professional men who would turn to photography in the early days. Only they had sufficient money and leisure time to pursue it as a hobby. Thomas Keith, another Edinburgh surgeon, found his inspiration nearer home. He was attracted to the closes and wynds around the High Street and Grassmarket, which he photographed in the 1850s. Keith used the waxed paper process, which gave a more finely detailed image. His own claim to have offered nothing original to the art is belied by these images, which testify to a marvellous eye and an acute sensitivity to the quality of light. He was one of the most dedicated amateurs of the period, but his work as a doctor restricted the times at which he could practice photography. As he had to be at work by 8 o'clock in the morning and was then busy until at least 4 o'clock in the afternoon, most of his photography was done either very early in the morning or late in the afternoon. The only exception to his own rule was when he was on holiday. And it was on a trip to Iona in September 1857 that Keith shows us his skills at their peak, using light and shade to splendid effect. The cathedral on Iona was at that time a romantic ruin, quite overgrown with weeds and creepers, a perfect subject for his sensitive approach to photography. The building has since been restored, but Keith's photographs show us what it looked like long before it was rebuilt. Sadly, Keith abandoned photography after only 5 years, when his medical commitments began to make greater calls on his time. Keith's brother-in-law, John Forbes White, was also a photographer of some considerable merit. He was a miller from Aberdeen, an enthusiastic artist and art collector. Working sometimes with Keith and sometimes on his own, White made a fine series of pictures of central and northern Scotland within the same few years of the mid-1850s. This is St. Macca's Cathedral in Aberdeen. By the mid-19th century, the steam revolution was taking hold in Scotland, and nowhere was this more evident than on the Clyde. The river was widened to take the bigger cargo vessels, and a flourishing shipbuilding industry had sprung up on its banks. On available evidence, Glasgow appears to have been less well served by dedicated amateur photographers than Edinburgh. But recently, an exceptional collection of over 300 prints has come to light, providing a fascinating record of life in Glasgow and on the river. It was the work of one man, a descendant of the legendary Rob Roy MacGregor, no less. His name was Duncan Brown. Born in 1817, Brown took up photography in the early 1850s, and most of his surviving pictures date from that period. This little iron paddle steamer, the Carradale, was built in 1860. It could be beached safely, and was the forerunner of the famous Clyde puffers, or short-haul cargo vessels. A group of foremen at Napier's shipyard posed for Brown in 1858. Robert Napier's yard and engineering shop became virtually a school of shipbuilding, and these men were among the world's leading experts in steam navigation. Radical changes were taking place in shipbuilding. The transitional stage between sail and steam propulsion is clearly seen in this ocean-going ship on its way up the Clyde. The Douglas was the fastest ship afloat when she was launched in 1858 and was used as a blockade runner by the Union States in the American Civil War. The steamer Mary Jane at Tarbert on Loch Fyne. She's about to leave for Glasgow with passengers and 500 boxes of herring. A dramatic view of the quarries at Furness, with some 34 citizens of the realm standing very still for the duration of the exposure. Two criminals, Arkwright and Benson, photographed in Glasgow in 1856, well and truly manacled together and held by a local law officer. This is possibly the earliest photograph of prisoners in Scotland. Robert Burns' daughter, Mrs. Thompson, posed for Brown in 1852. Later, he also photographed Burns' granddaughter, Mrs. Wingate. They were among many celebrities of the day who sat for Brown. Queen Victoria's gillie, John Brown, was a relative of the photographer. It is 1862, and he's wearing a mourning armband in memory of Prince Albert. The Glasgow Literary and Artists Club and a ramble to Hag's Castle in 1858. The Caledonian Cricket Club playing a home match on their ground near Charing Cross. Voluntary military service was fashionable among the middle classes. There was an unusually high proportion of officers in the companies they formed. And finally, a family snapshot on the Braes of Balquhidder, close to Brown's and Rob Roy's home. In contrast to Duncan Brown's documentary approach, Lady Clementina Hay-Warden was exploring the power of photography to capture and create atmosphere. Lady Clementina was born at Cumbernauld House in 1822. She was the daughter of Charles Elphinstone Fleming, MP for Stirlingshire and Governor of the Greenwich Hospital. Lady Clementina moved south to England on her marriage to the fourth Viscount Hay-Warden, and her interest in photography seems to have developed in the late 1850s. By the early 1860s, she was exhibiting her work and receiving widespread acclaim. Clementina was the daughter of one of Scotland's wealthiest families, so the circles in which she moved were the rich and aristocratic, and her friends included the leading literary and artistic figures of the day. She was a close friend of Charles Dodgson, Lewis Carroll, who believed her to be one of the finest portrait photographers of the time. Dodgson, himself a keen amateur photographer, introduced his favourite sitters to Lady Hawarden. Her pictures have a power which denies their great age. The subtle use of lighting and delicate posing of the subjects and her sense of composition show her to be a photographer of immense talent. Sadly, her pictures were taken during only a few years, and in 1865, at the age of only 42, she died. The photographs lay forgotten in the Victoria and Albert Museum for many years, and only now are receiving the attention and appreciation they deserve. Posed though they obviously are, Lady Hawarden's photographs have the appearance of capturing the moment. But it was not until the 1880s that instantaneous photography became a reality. One of the first amateurs to seize on the new possibility was Matthew Morrison, a Paisley coppersmith and plumber. Materials were faster and manufacturers were now making ready-made plates, relieving the photographer of the tedious task of making his own. The plates were also much more sensitive, and though still slow by today's standards, they could be used under conditions which would have been unthinkable in the days of Thomas Keith or Lady Hawarden. The candid camera had arrived. Morrison had been a founder member of the local photographic society in 1866. These Paisley street scenes, taken between 1880 and 1894, show how he had an eye for telling incidental detail. With more portable equipment and shorter exposure times, he was able to observe more discreetly and record life as it happened, lending his pictures a distinctive energy and immediacy. While he photographed the men who worked in his own yard, Morrison was more interested in the way people spent their leisure time. The Clyde Coast was becoming a fashionable area for holidays. Stick fighting was a less dangerous version of fencing, though by the look of the sticks and the men who wielded them, not much less dangerous. Here they are resting after their exertions. Morrison was clearly influenced by contemporary Victorian painting, taking as much care over composition as content. He approached his subjects with a gentle, sympathetic eye. The pictures were rediscovered only a few years ago on the premises of Morrison and MacDonald, the firm he founded over a century ago. The amateur tradition continued into the 20th century. There are millions of us who take snapshots purely for the family album. This practice dates from the introduction of the Kodak box camera, which made photography simple, cheap, and more readily available. There was no longer the need to know the theory and chemistry of how it worked. Photography had lost much of its mystique. There was a new kind of intimacy between photographer and subject. Pitlochry in 1902, and the procession staged on King Edward VII's coronation day. Other pictures chronicle family outings in the Perthshire countryside. A Picnic by the Falls of Brewer. These are taken from the snapshot albums of James Masterton, a schoolteacher, and one of the many thousands of enthusiasts in Scotland at the turn of the century. Some albums compiled by amateurs of the period were more serious in intention. Leslie Hamilton Wilson was a keen observer of life in Edwardian times, his photo journal spanning the years 1895 to 1927. His photographs of the Scottish landscape have a brooding, haunted quality. Wilson was a businessman for whom photography was an absorbing hobby. After training in his father's brokerage firm in Glasgow, he moved on to found his own company and achieved considerable financial success. He observed in a restrained, understated manner the life of his own privileged class, beginning with family and friends. This is on the ferry at Ballahoolish. These are not snapshots, but carefully composed pictures. The photographs are all meticulously captioned. This one is called Mr. Boyd Reno. This is Mr. Scott B. Symington. During the First World War, Wilson joined the Ayrshire Yeomanry and served for the duration as an officer. His photographs record none of the bloodshed or horror of that war, but focus on the camaraderie and fellowship of army life. Even bayonet practice is the air of a gentlemanly pursuit. Over 2,000 of Wilson's original platinum prints are contained in leather-bound volumes at Harvard University. He set aside 4 months of each year for traveling and took his camera to many parts of the world. His Indian photographs are typical of his ability to capture a sense of place. Wilson spent an enormous amount of time and effort on his hobby. Several volumes are devoted to the Scottish whaling industry, documenting the course of a trip from the moment the whaling ship left harbour to the time, months later, when the final cargo was delivered to Glasgow.
Our ship is well rigged and she's ready to sail. The crew, they are anxious to follow. Covered with one for a man to live there. And the king of that country is the fierce Greenland bear. And there'll be no temptation to tarry long there. With our ship bumper full, we will homeward repair.
While Wilson was engaged on this early excursion into photojournalism, others were experimenting with new processes which affected the appearance and character of the photograph. It was a new oil process which appealed to Alexander Wilson Hill, a bank manager at Loch Boisdale and South Uist in the closing years of the last century. Hill had been a painter before photography caught his imagination. His obsession led him to produce a quite remarkable series of pictures between 1894 and the beginning of the Second World War. In those 45 years, always working as an amateur, he took the oil and gum process to a high level of both artistic and technical achievement. The delicate images have the appearance and the appeal of etchings. As the ink was applied by hand, each print is unique. The photographs were the result of hours of patient work. Different inks and different papers were used to impart individual qualities to each print. Oil printing was all the rage between the wars. Many tried, but few achieved such results. His compositions are compelling and his treatment delightful, leaving us with a personal view of Scotland second to none in its day. In the months before he died in 1949, Hill ruthlessly edited his collection of pictures, destroying any which he felt were not good enough. The pictures that remain are those that the photographer himself enjoyed. Historians find the amateur pictures of the last 100 years a valuable aid to their work. They show crafts, customs, people and places accurately and clearly. The pictures being taken today will serve the same purpose in years to come. The amateur tradition ensures that the ordinary, everyday things of life are preserved.
And bring the flowers that are coming that way. Son, if you walk straight out the way, that's a good lad. You're okay, but wait a minute, if you both stay with me, if you look to me, that's it, and bring your head forward just a wee bit, in a wee bit closer, and bring your flowers up just a wee bit higher, that's us, and both of you looking this way, all ready, great big smile now, good, now, could you all look at the bride and groom this time, if you all look in towards the bride and groom, if you turn towards each other, and could the bride and groom now just give a wee quick kiss, the bride and groom, give a wee quick, you've got a license, a wee quick kiss now, that's us. No, wait a minute, that was too quick. Wait a minute. Excuse me, bride, if you turn yourself and look up at the groom. That's it. Groom, bring your head down a wee bit closer. That's it. And just almost kiss now. That's it. We've a lot to learn, lass.